Blackstone Audio presents Ideas Have Consequences, Expanded Edition, by Richard M. Weaver. This book is read by Frederick Davidson. Foreword and afterword read by Derek Perkins. The Consequences of Richard Weaver, by Roger Kimball. The past shows unvaryingly that when a people's freedom disappears, it goes not with a bang, but in silence, amid the comfort of being cared for. That is the dire peril in the present trend toward statism. If freedom is not found accompanied by a willingness to resist and to reject favors, rather than to give up what is intangible but precarious, it will not long be found at all. Richard Weaver, 1962. The simple process of preserving our present civilization is supremely complex and demands incalculably subtle powers. Ortega y Gasset, 1930. In the great pantheon of half-forgotten conservative sages, the Southern writer Richard M. Weaver, 1910-63, occupies an important, if curious, niche. I say writer, but that is an imprecise designation. By trade, Weaver was a professor of rhetoric. He is even the author of a textbook on the subject. One friend said that Weaver was a rhetor doing the work of a philosopher. It might be more accurate to say that he was a critic doing the work of a prophet. Prophets, as a species, tend to specialize in bad news. They rarely return from the mountain, reporting that the management has concluded that everything down below is just fine. Weaver was no exception to this rule. He made his reputation as a latter-day Isaiah, bearing admonitory tidings to an inattentive populace. Above all, perhaps, he was an acolyte of what he lovingly called lost causes. The fact that a cause had lost, he argued, did not necessarily rob it of nobility. It did not mean that we could not learn something from the ideals that inspired it. It did not even mean that, ultimately, it was really lost. For what is lost might also be regained. It might serve not only as a reminder, but also as a model, a new goal. In the longer run, as Weaver put it, what seemed lost might eventually prove victorious. Such, anyway, were among the explicit rationales that Weaver offered about the value of lost causes. An additional attraction, I suspect, lay in the romance of defeat. Things reveal themselves passing away. Weaver liked to quote that Yeatsian line. I believe he cherished the passing away as much as the accompanying revelation. Weaver the man was, or became, almost as eccentric as his work. Born in North Carolina, he was the first of four children. His father, an outgoing man who owned a livery stable, died when Richard was only six, and his mother was expecting her last child. The family eventually resettled in Lexington, Kentucky, where his mother managed Embry and Company, a millinery business owned by her brother. Although Weaver became a formidable debater, he was a shy, bookish boy. His sister Polly remembers him sequestered in his bedroom for hours on end with the family typewriter. He blossomed socially in college, though his intellectual vocation seems to have settled upon him only gradually. In an autobiographical essay called Up from Liberalism, 1958, Weaver recalls that in his undergraduate years at the University of Kentucky, earnest professors had him persuaded entirely that the future was with science, liberalism, and equalitarianism. By the time he graduated in 1932, the Great Depression had swept the country, and Weaver, like many others, had evolved into a full-fledged socialist. He served as secretary of the campus Socialist Party, and during Norman Thomas's presidential campaign, rose to be secretary of the statewide Socialist Party. His metanoia began at Vanderbilt, where he came under the mesmerizing spell of John Crow Ransom, the subtle doctor, to whom he dedicated The Southern Tradition at Bay. First published in 1968, 5 years after Weaver's death, the book began life as a dissertation, completed in 1943 under the great...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.